wanted to Steve Saylor. I came to see the detailed statistics of mortgage default rates. You gave the second half of your presentation, showed as high as percentage of default among banks, lowest percentage of minus.
Institutions were allowed to encourage to draw upon their empirical experience with different types of lenders. However, in the United States for decades, that has been absolutely against the law. And so that, in fact, it's not just against the law to treat not lend at equal rates to different groups, but even discussing questions of whether you get paid back can expose your financial institution to a lot of danger in lawsuits. Typically, companies are sued routinely for discrimination, and plaintiffs' attorneys ask in the discovery process for all the emails and memos. So if it turns out that somebody, some vice president somewhere, wrote down something and says, you know, we're making a whole lot of loans in all Mexican district in San Bernardino for $400,000 up, where's the money going to come from to pay for this? Are we sure what people aren't just going out and blowing it on quinceañera parties? Memo comes out, if an email like that gets discovered, it's going to be all over the newspapers. The guy who wrote it's going to get fired. His CEO is going to have to go down to the National Council of La Raza and promise to lend even more money to minorities. So basically, it's all been just kind of pounded out of the consciousness of society. It's the kind of thing you can talk about in drinks, but these different default rates, different time preferences, and so forth, are basically radioactive to think about in any kind of written fashion. And so people don't. And it winds up costing a huge amount of money. Thanks. Yes. Just wanted to mention, Steve, National Council of La Raza is a Latino pressure group. It translates as the National. It's just the National Council of the Race, which is a Mexican term for Mexicans, the race. Most people have most tribes down through history have terms like, we are the only human beings is the name of their group. So La Raza is a pressure group equivalent to, say, Jesse Jackson's for blacks.
If I understood you correctly, you've heard some studies that show that the IQ of British black kids at Harvard University were consistently lower than the IQs of poor white kids at the university.
Well, I didn't refer to IQ. The fact is that these academic achievement tests are very highly correlated with IQ. I did not say that the IQ of black students at Harvard is lower. I didn't mention that. The point is this. If you take, I can give you another example. There is a series of the National Assessment of Education Progress tests given to by the U.S. government to a broad section of Americans, children, first grade, third grade, sixth grade, in all sorts of fields. The average black sixth grader can solve a science problem as well as the average black 12th grader can solve a science problem as well as the average white sixth grader. But the interesting point is if you just take the children of black and white college graduates, the difference between the races is greater than if you take all blacks and whites. But that is Galton's law of regression to the mean. It's a fundamental law of genetics discovered by Francis Galton, who was Charles Darwin's first cousin. And he did it with height. If you have individuals, he was actually doing it with plants, any plant or animal. If the parents are abnormal for their gene pool on a given genetic factor, their offspring regress about halfway to the mean of the gene pool. Galton never applied that to intelligence. It was another man who made the Stanford Binet intelligence test, I can't remember his name, in California, who noticed that the children of poor, uneducated Jews and Orientals did better on the intelligence test than the children of wealthy, educated white Gentiles. He realized this was a regression to the mean of the gene pool. Only later was it seen that also applied to blacks and whites, that there's a very strong regression to the mean of that gene pool. Now, for instance, I'll give you another instance. At any given IQ of the parents, black children are 13 times more likely to be mentally retarded in the United States. In other words, the children of black parents with a 120 IQ have much less of a chance of being mentally retarded than the children of black parents with an 80 IQ. But the children of black parents with 120 IQ are 13 times more likely to be mentally retarded than the children of white parents with a 120 IQ.
If I might say something about affirmative action at Harvard, there's been a controversy in recent years led by Henry Louis Gates, the head of the African-American Studies Department, and Lonnie Muir, Harvard Law School. They've been pointing out, it hasn't been very popular what they've been saying, but they've been pointing out that Harvard's African-American students are largely not really African-Americans. They're a lot more like Barack Obama than they are like Michelle Obama. They tend to be the African-American students who get into Harvard tend to be have either a white parent or grandparent or are immigrant stock from the Caribbean or Africa, Barack Obama being a classic example. Michelle Obama is genuine African-American descendant from slaves on all four grandparents' sides. When people think about affirmative action, they often think about it as compensation for slavery. But like in the case of Harvard, they're just basically, they aren't coming up with enough Harvard quality students, so they're reaching out and taking in all sorts of foreign students and people like Barack Obama who were raised in a white environment. So Bunir and Gates have been pointing this out, and nobody really wants to think about it.
That's part Professor Hoppe insisted my talk be 30 minutes, and for 3 weeks I went over it at least an hour a day, crossing out sentences and paragraphs and single words to get it down there. But that would have been part of it when I said the vast majority, I show this in my book, the vast majority of blacks who receive benefit from affirmative action in the United States are immigrants or the descendants of immigrants who came after 1965. And that survey, there was a survey conducted among Harvard undergraduates by a black student. The Harvard administration tried to stop the survey. She came from the United States, and she was completely black. And she said when she told her, when her black fellow students asked her where she came from, and she said the United States, they'd reply incredulously, "No, where do you really come from?"
A question to Professor Goldfried about the Daniels. Professor Goldfried, as far as I understand, if you do not consider that this mark you have in the state is a predecessor of the modern European government state, but it's more different than what they get a very model intended to control and testify around the class. Now, taking into account of the Daniels program from the other class, they do indeed seem to constitute a political problem given
themselves as Frenchmen. Well, obviously, people coming don't think of themselves you know, as admirers of the Habsburgs or Kaiser Wilhelm or Bismarck. They really have no identification with these countries where they're coming to live. And there are parallel societies which the political class is setting up. So I think as a first measure to deal with these terminally ill nations, or perhaps terminally ill nations, I would try to remove the immigration problem as much as I could. I also would cut the immigration, I would not give any kind of special treatment to those immigrants who are there. And if they commit crimes, they should be deported at once, even if they're not some PPA, even if they're illegally there. They should be removed from the country. But I think it's also important simply to end the kind of immigration flood that's been coming into Europe and do this very, very seriously. And for these nations to sort of take stock of themselves and to try to understand the requirements to be nations. Part of it is an escape through immigration into from what they are historically. And there's a desire to lose their identity in something else, a kind of multicultural world. I think they really have to come to grips with this emotional and the sheer emotional problem. And immigration is not going to really, the immigration is going to add to crime, it's going to add to social problems. The only ones who are going to benefit are the social workers and the governing class, which is involved in re-socializing the indigenous population.
Yes, I'm not altogether keen on the notion of an underclass, at least in Britain, because the problem is much wider than that of an underclass. I was, for a time, the vulgarity correspondent of a British newspaper, which was not itself completely immune from vulgarity, but they used to send me wherever the British were gathering and behaving badly, which of course was more or less wherever they were gathering. And on one occasion they sent me to a so-called friendly football match between Italy and England. And of course Rome hadn't seen anything like it since 410 AD. There are about 10,000 people in the English building, crowd, and they were all, of course, shouting obscenities for hours on end and making what were very similar to fascist salutes. And I think I was the only one out of 10,000 who wasn't. And at half time, it had all calmed down a little, and I spoke to the chap next to me and I said, excuse me, I hope you don't mind me asking this, but why have you come all this way to shout obscenities at the Italians for hours? And he said, well, I have to let my hair down. The point about these people who were behaving so badly was that they were all middle class, and they had very good jobs. In fact, they were auctioneers from Sotheby's.
The revelations about some of this, but
they all had very good jobs. So there is, at least in Britain, an idea or a reversal, like a Gestalt switch of what is considered good and bad, so that we now, I don't know whether you know the lines from Paradise Lost, but when Satan is expelled from heaven, he says, evil, be thou my good. And that is what has happened in to a large extent in Britain. So the problem is not one of immigrants, in my view. The fact that we have abandoned our own attractive characters makes us it makes it impossible for us to absorb immigrants. And when I look at the behaviour of people in Britain, and I try to look at it with the eyes of an immigrant, I can't see why they would wish to integrate themselves into this mess.
I'd like to ask a question. All of my friends, teller, but I'm not a fortune teller, so I can't presume to know the future in any regard, including this one, but I have what you might call educated speculations. I'm quite sure that it will not end because Ron Paul is elected president. So if you want to bank on that, feel confident. But I think economic difficulties will increasingly constrain the maintenance of the American empire and are already beginning to do so. For the moment, the U.S. government is acting as if there are no constraints and everything can be dealt with simply by creating more money. But that solution will soon be revealed as bankrupt, literally, because it's self-defeating. And when it is seen to be self-defeating, there won't, in my view, be any good alternatives to it other than constriction of the scope of the American empire. So I can foresee some base closures, some reductions in military spending, some other changes that will diminish the size and reach of American military forces on a worldwide scale. How far that will go depends on how bad the financial collapse or other forms of financial difficulty turn out to be. And there we get into so many uncertainties that I'm not willing to make many educated guesses other than that I believe within the next 1 to 3 years, accelerating inflation will probably reach levels that cause the American authorities to impose price controls. And once price controls are imposed, then so many difficulties ensue because of those controls that it's hard to say what happens. Of course, they're harmful to economic productivity, so they limit real output, they increase poverty, and so ultimately, people may realize, as they always have in the past when Americans have imposed price controls, that it would be good to give up the controls and restore a more normal type of economy. I think that's going to be more difficult to do on this occasion. I don't think, however, the probability of doing it is zero. We had a very great increase of money stock during World War II, combined with wage and price controls and many other forms of economic control. So in fact, during World War II, the United States had a command in mind. What looked like any markets were so constrained and rigged controlled indirectly, if not directly, that the whole economy can actually be considered a command economy. But that was terminated after the war ended. For the most part, free price system was allowed to operate once again, and an adjustment was made to the fact that the money stock had nearly doubled during the war. So what will happen in the future now may resemble what happened then. If it does, we'll be the luckiest people on earth. I don't think it will go so well this time for a variety of reasons, but if you take the far field and the regular conjecture and guesswork to say any more.
Thank you. it counts completely without finding a different side of our world today, how much less money could have been spent?
Well, that's a very large question, and the best answer I can give to it would be a kind of rough and ready guess. I'm fairly sure that we could have got equally good results at half the expense. I think until you actually delve into the inner workings of the military-industrial congressional complex, you really cannot appreciate the degree of sheer waste, absurdity, idiocy that goes on there and that continues year after year. Studies that have been made since the 1950s by so-called Blue Ribbon Commissions to study the Department of Defense and its contracting operations in particular with private suppliers. Each one of these major studies reaches almost identical conclusions because nothing ever changes fundamentally. By the 1950s, the people who benefit most from the operation of this apparatus had entrenched it so deeply that nothing can be done by critics to change it, to diminish it. I think the only real hope of diminishing the amount of sheer waste in the defense apparatus is if the entire government budget shrinks so that the military portion has to shrink along with it. It can be starved, but otherwise I think it is the closest thing we have in this world to a perpetual theft machine. My old friend, Ernie Fitzgerald, who was an efficiency engineer for the Air Force for more than 50 years and became famous when President Nixon said on one of the tapes, "Fire that son of a bitch." And after 10 years in the courts, got his job back with some compensation. Ernie used to say, a defense contract is a license to steal. And I think that's a pretty good definition of what it is or how it works.
Yeah, my question is, currently the U.S. spends about half of all military spending in the world, and everyone else in the world's military spending as a percentage of their GDP, just about everything else, has been headed down. It's really quite low. The U.S. is stuck at about 4% of GDP. I guess the really big question is everybody else backing off on military spending because the U.S. is so dominant, or is it just because basically they don't see war as pain anymore? War used to be very profitable when you grab some territory, you got the farmers and the minerals, but now it's mostly buildings and war kills people and breaks things, is there any way to make money out of it? So I guess the big question, I don't have an answer to it, is if the U.S. cut back on military spending, would other countries go, wow, this is our chance, or they just say, well, it took you so long, war just doesn't pay.
Now, I want to make a comment in response to what you said about, it was good that the Americans were there when the Russians were coming in from the east, and I think this is sort of focused the issue on the timeliness of American presence in wars. How good it was that the Americans pulled the chestnuts of the French out of the fire in World War I or something like this. One could also, of course, point to the fact that American involvement in wars very often caused harm in complicated military situations that might have been resolved differently, such as World War I, which might actually have been ended with a negotiated peace between the two sides once they had finished fighting with each other. The problem is that at least since the early 20th century, there has been a well-organized group that has controlled American foreign policy, or at least has sold certain foreign policy to the country. our major foreign policy magazines, such as Foreign Affairs, are controlled by this group. And it's the Council on Foreign Relations, which has existed since 1919, when Elihu Root, the Progressive Republican, together with various Democrats, came together and founded it for the purpose of involving the United States in the affairs of Europe. And we're always told it's a terrible thing the United States did not join the League of Nations. I think it's a very good thing they did not join the League of Nations, because it would have been perpetually committed to keeping down the Germans in the 1920s when on the side of the English and the French. And I think we should maintain the kind of neutrality once the war was over. We probably should not have been involved in the war in the first place. But the continuing involvement in the United States in European affairs, the use of American armies to spread the democratic values of the United States, all these things have been pushed by the Council on Foreign Relations. And the only regret of the Council on Foreign Relations is that most Americans do not think constantly about foreign involvement. And needless to say, there is a military-industrial complex that is very supportive of the Council on Foreign Relations. And there are, in fact, interlocking groups that are responsible for American what's well, very often called bilateralism in our foreign policy is the fact that the Republicans and Democrats are both equally involved in the business of exporting American democracy, committing American troops abroad, and so forth. So that even if one can find occasionally good or benevolent usage of the American military, it has in fact been a kind of perpetual machine involving it, and it has been connected to bankers such as the Rockefeller family, which is supportive of the Council on Foreign Relations and supportive of foreign policy, the Morgan family in World War I. So you have our interlocking economic, ideological interests that have been behind the creation of this vast American empire that Bob has been describing.
Thank you, first of all, for your explanation of some of the major causes of the economic crisis. My question is the following. Do you think, ex-ante, that there could be or there was any level of understanding that the group's monetary policy of the Fed and its groundwork into regulation in the U.S. would have caused such a terrible outcome, and there was an attempt to prevent it or to limit the effects?
Yeah, thank you. So the question is, would something else have gone terribly wrong if it weren't for this? Is that a good question?
Yeah, well, my first question is whether what you said was known in advance. So in back in 1997 or near 2000, there was anybody within the bank sector or within the government or whatever who said, go on this way, any economic crisis with any outcome?
No, I don't think it just never came up. A confession of my own. I can vividly recall looking at a newspaper in about the year 2002, reading a little article that said that that Fannie Mae, the government-sponsored enterprise that buys up bundles of mortgages, had just committed to $440 billion to President Bush's program for increasing minority home ownership. And I looked at that and I thought, you know, $440 billion here, $440 billion there, pretty soon you're talking about real money. And then I put the newspaper aside and basically didn't think about it again for several years. And I would suspect I'm more cynical than most people. So basically, this seemed like a really good idea to everybody who was anybody in America, Democrats and Republicans. One of the funny things is, for example, that I have not found a single partisan Democrat who has attacked George Bush's, has mentioned George Bush's White House conference on increasing minority home ownership. They've attacked him for everything else, But this whole series of steps leading up to that conference where he leaned on everybody to cut down payment requirements and told and sent a message to federal regulators, you know, to basically not take the punch bowl away from the party when things get interesting. Not a single liberal in the United States has even mentioned that event. You can Google all of them, but it hasn't come up because it's much more important within the United States for Democrats to denounce Republicans as racist than it is for them to put together a coherent story of how Republicans wreck the economy. So basically, everybody thought, who said anything in public, said, thought this was a fine idea. And so nobody saw it coming because we basically have our reality helmet fields up to basically not pay attention to these things involving race. So we're paying the price.
Actually, I'd like to, after this, I'd like to question someone real quick. Go ahead, Jensen.
Yes, question for Steve Saylor. You proved conclusively in my eyes that the dark Obama inherited from his father, the dream of being a great political leader and to do good for the black race. Now, I think I read somewhere that Obama's father was also a Marxist. So then the question is, to what extent did Barack Obama also inherit
Yeah, it's a good question. To review a little bit, Barack Obama Sr. met Anna Dunham when she was 17-year-old co-ed, and they got married a couple months later, they gave him away. And then Barack Sr. was graduated from the University of Hawaii in 3 years. He was there on a Cold War scholarship program to bring young elites from Kenya to the United States as part of a Cold War struggle for the hearts and minds of Kenyans. After he graduated in just 3 years, instead of the usual four, he was top of his class and got a scholarship to Harvard. At that point, he also had a scholarship offered to another college in New York that would pay for his wife and son to come along. But Harvard was Harvard, so he went to Harvard and left his wife and son behind, married an American woman when he was there. I guess that would be his third wife, but I mean, he still had a wife in Kenya. The bigamous aspect is really gets kind of downplayed. All right. At that point, so basically, Barack only Jr. only saw Barack Sr. for 1 month after that. However, he heard about his father all the time from his mother, because she then fell in love with another third world student at the University of Hawaii, an Indonesian fellow named Lolo. And he was another leftist, you know, talked of revolution and so forth. And they got married, and then after about a year, and then he had to go into the Indonesian army. And then she moved, then Mrs. Obama, so Dunham Obama Solotero by this point, moved to Indonesia. But when she got there, she discovered she was no longer in love with her second husband. And in fact, she started to find him real annoying because he just wasn't the romantic revolutionary he'd been as a student in Hawaii. He was now working for an American oil company, diligently rising up the corporate ladder, and he was always asking her to come to dinners with his American contacts because it was, you know, they'll expect you there. You were their people, and she would get very mad at him and say, "They are not my people." Her second husband was proving to be a very good stepfather to young Barack Jr. He was really teaching him how to be, you know, how to get by and really helping him out with all sorts of things. And she increasingly resented her second husband's influence over her son. And to counter that, as Barack Jr. describes in some detail, the only authority figure she could come up with was his biological father, who was now back in Kenya, and occasionally would write letters, but mostly she sort of created a myth about him that The reason he couldn't be with his beloved son was because he had to go back to his country to fight for his people, to write, to become a political leader, to do the proper thing, to work, to lead his people to greatness, unlike his stepfather, who's merely supporting his wife and stepson. And so she sort of basically inculcated an ideology, a black racialist ideology in her son, as part of her kind of passive-aggressive war on her Indonesian second husband. It took, Obama believed it all. It was quite shocking to him when he was in his later 20s, around age 26, when he finally discovered from his half-siblings in Kenya that his father's had failed terribly in life due to alcoholism, drunken car crashes, and so forth. We do know a lot about what his father had felt up through about the year 1965. This is presumably what his father had told his mother, and his mother then passed on this ideology to her son. And that is that Barack Sr. wrote a paper in 1965 kind of criticizing Tom Mboya's African socialism, which was kind of a more moderate, politically centrist point of view, generally to the light of most of African thinking at the time. The key point was, for Barack Sr., was that Tom Mboya and his boss, Jomo Kenyatta, did not intend to take away the property of whites and Asian businesses in Kenya. And Barack Sr. took what we might now call rather Mugabeist line about that since whites and Asians dominated the Kenyan economy, they basically had to be expropriated. So I'm not sure if I would call it really Marxist. I don't see much in this article that was published by Barack Sr. in 1965 that's distinctly Marxist. It's more kind of, you know, socialist, yes, but it's more kind of international, it's more racial socialism than socialism for its own sake. In comparison to Robert Mugabe stands out. So, sorry about taking a long time, but that is kind of the intellectual background that he was raised in. And so when he talks about his deepest commitments, that is something that would be interesting to ask him. It explains a lot about why he spent 20 years in Reverend Jeremiah Wright's church, why he gave over $50,000 to Reverend Wright since his election to the United States Senate. It seems like a fairly simple and straightforward explanation that he sought out Jeremiah Wright because he agreed with him.
Now, I have a question direct to Mr. Hicks here. After what happened? After he spoke, I came up and I asked him about the Korean War. Didn't he think that was justified? He said no. He did have to agree that the people of South Korea were incomparably better off because the United States did prevent the North Korean invasion. But what about this point that has been made? If in 1945, after the Second World War was over, United States would have withdrawn its troops completely from the United States, mostly disarmed, left enough of a force it thought could defend the United States itself from attack, make it clear that that's all the United States is going to do. It's nearly certain that the Soviet Union would have imposed communist regimes throughout continental Europe. Decades of tyranny, murder, torture, starvation. Don't you think the United States had to keep a strong military presence to prevent that? Yes, I'm asking.
I don't know what was necessary at that point. It's certainly the case that with the United States there to bulk up the Western Europeans, it was easier to fend off the Soviets at that point. I'm not sure what the point of the question is.
Well, should the United States have done what you seem to be advocating as a general principle with no exceptions, the United States just an army to defend its own borders? Or have I gotten you wrong? Because in order to defend, where the Soviet Union had the most powerful and the largest manned army in the world at that time, in order to have a credible defense of Western Europe, the United States had to keep up a good size on
it. May I jump into this?
Yes.
Because I think this is an interesting question. No, I do not think the United States should have pulled out of Europe in 1945. I also do not believe that the United States should have entered World War I, should have been co-responsible for the Treaty of Versailles. I do not think it should have firebombed all those cities in 1944 and 1945. It should not have yielded as often as it did, nor should the British have yielded as often as they did to Stalin. They probably could have ended the Second World War by negotiating with the non-Nazi government in Germany, which existed, but which Churchill helped to undermine. After all those mistakes were made by the United States, though I think it should have stayed in Europe in 1945 and keep the rest of the continent from being swallowed up by Stalin, yes, I do. On the other hand, I don't think we should forget all the mistakes that were made before that that brought about that situation in 1945. I don't think European history did not start in 1945, nor did it start in 1938. And I think America is responsible, or co-responsible, for many of the mistakes that were made throughout the history of the early 20th century.
I'll say a little more in response to the question. It's a little difficult for me at this stage of my thinking to wrap my mind around that kind of question. People talk in those terms all the time. Should the United States do this? Should Britain do that? And so forth. This, to my mind, is a way of thinking about my being advisor to the prince. And in my mind, all these princes are criminals. All of them. And so questions like this put me in the position of saying, should criminal number 3 have done such and such vis-a-vis criminal number 17? Well, that's a difficult question to answer. I tend to think more in terms of questions of right and wrong conduct by individuals. Think in terms of individuals protecting themselves from criminals, who, particularly those who form and operate nation states. I think in terms of free people, individuals, all of whom are beset by criminals on all sides. Usually, the most menacing criminal of all is the government that purports to be their own ruler. All of these criminals can do this good that they do, such as fending off the Red Army and keeping it out of France and Holland. They can do it only by committing a multitude of crimes of their own, and not otherwise. They cannot operate in any other fashion. These nation states cannot get resources except by threatening to kill people who will not cough up resources to them, which in my mind is extortion at best. So I don't give advice to the prince, neither Prince Number 3 nor Prince Number 17.
But if I want, for instance, to have a Filipino maid or a Senegalese driver or an accountant from India, and maybe 10 accountants or India, such as the state of my finances. And I was, why should I be prevented, and on what ground would other people prevent me from importing the stuff? That is the first question. And I think that to answer other issues that have been discussed about multiculturalism, isn't it a misnomer? Is it the problem of most immigrants that they simply do not have a culture? So there isn't multiculturalism. There are people who may or may not have a culture in a certain country, and other people who come in who are completely destructured without any sort of culture to speak of. My problem is when I am with people of different races, different cultures, different origins, and so on, is whether they are honest, whether they are going to bug me in the street. It's a problem of criminality, and this applies to any nationality or any ethnic group and so on. And good. Look, I think somebody has mentioned on the panel that it is going to change the culture of the United States, it's going to change the culture of England and so on. So many things change the culture of a country. Think of cinema in the 1920s, of television in the 1950s, of the internet in the 1990s. A lot of things are changing the culture. So if there are groups of people who come and have a strong culture, not folklore, but a strong culture, living in a neighborhood, living in another town, or living in the same town, in the same building, is it really a problem if we are honest and so on?
Well, let me jump in here. The argument for open borders can be an appealing one, in theory.
Sorry, can I just stop you here?
Yes, please.
I didn't say open borders. I said if I import people because I want to work with them from India and so on, that is not an argument for open borders. It is the same argument as open trade. In other words, if I buy a foreign car, if a foreign car comes to this country, it is because I bought it or somebody else bought it. It's not because it landed on my doorstep.
Yeah, there's a couple of points. One is the issue of privatizing profits while socializing costs. As a Californian, very sensitive to this, a lot of studies have been done. For example, for California has long imported a huge number of migrant farm workers to do student labor. The farms in California are much less mechanized than the ones in Australia, for example, because they have a very cheap supply of labor from south of the border. However, it's not clear that the large landowners account for all costs of education, of healthcare, of policing, imprisonment, and so forth and so on. California right now, if you're looking at newspapers, is basically broke, trying to get more handouts from the federal government. On the supply side, the number of people who who could want to move to the United States is quite large. A fascinating statistic I stumbled upon is that the number of people in the world who live in countries with lower per capita GDP than Mexico is about 5,043,000,000. So there is an almost unlimited supply of potential economic immigrants to the United States, who it would take a long time before the standard of living in the United States would plummet down to the level of Bangladesh. So the question is, what we've been seeing is that large-scale immigration in California can lead typically of people with little education. They have good work habits, but not much education to bring to it. Plate has turned out to be extremely expensive, as we've seen with mortgage lending, with the deficits run by the state of California. It's really been an experiment in what happens. Then you have the political changes. California voted for the Republican candidate for president every year from 1952 to 1988, with the exception of 1964, 9 out of 10 times. It's gone Democratic in the last 5 elections. That has a lot to do with immigration. New immigrants tend to vote for tax and spend candidates on very rational grounds. It also has an impact on the natives. People in California, they increasingly make their living with, say, government civil service jobs, kind of minding more as teachers versus prison guards and so forth. Well, I would suggest that one thing about America's immigration system is it tends to be very emotionally driven, with all sorts of appeals to the Statue of Liberty and so forth. Other civilized countries like Canada and Australia have a more rational system, where they make you apply and prove your usefulness to the current citizens of Canada or Australia. About 8 years ago, I went online and I took the test to see if I was worthy of immigrating to Canada, and I failed. And I must say that, I was rather impressed. Groucho Marx said he didn't want to belong to any club that would have him. So it kind of made me feel like I wanted to move to Canada. But those are different kind of systems, and they do take into account some of these costs by trying. Canada has basically been trying to skim the cream off the human capital from around the world. Now, that has a lot of problems, but you don't see Canada going broke the way California currently is.
Could I also answer this? In the United States, you have the peculiar problem that all non-European immigrants, no matter how rich or educated they are eligible for affirmative action along with their descendants, seemingly for all time. But it isn't only the United States. France, the French government kept telling the French people, we need these Arab and black immigrants to do work that French people are no longer willing to do. Now something like 35% of Arab and black men between the ages of 18 and 40 in France are unemployed. And the government is desperately trying to make employment for the people who are supposed to be there doing work that French people didn't want to do. And for years, France has now had affirmative action for blacks and Arabs so they can do jobs that French people do want to do and take them for French people who are much more qualified to do them.
Yeah, I wanted to add something too about the notion that cultures continue to change. I think we probably would disagree here on the nature of community, because I do believe there are national communities which are continuing communities, although they're not entirely fixed. But I think that what is happening now is that the government is imposing multiculturalism. It is not that the culture is simply changing. The government is reshaping the culture and using immigrants at least partly to do this. And you see this in the United States with the attempt to sort of push Hispanic culture, government support for a group with a racist name like La Gaza. Something that David Ferrer mentioned, the way minorities coming in. Excuse me?
Stephen Ferrer
mentioned the way those minorities coming in from other parts of the world are immediately eligible for affirmative action. And the effect of these government actions is not to simply allow the culture to evolve, it is to force the culture in a politically correct direction.
I think we should take a break.